Hey everyone! We'll go with it. Welcome to episode 7.
This time it's for real.
Of Aches and Nerds with Doc and Donnie. I am Dr. Hayes Estes. Donnie! What's up, man?
Hey man, what's up? It's baseball. Baseball. So we're going to go ahead and
Margaret Thatcher. Baseball.
Yeah, we're not there yet. We're going to date this episode for the Rays just won the AL East. Boom. Even though it was only 60 games. But we're going to say that. Hey. How did your Giants do?
I don't think they played this year.
Yeah, they might as well have not played. They should have just forfeited the season.
Does this season count?
Whoever wins,
I mean,
is
listen.
Count.
If the Rays, this is how Tampa Bay is going to win its own one and only World Series is in a season like this, we're in a pandemic. Whatever, we play 60 games, and then they play in a bubble where there's no fan. Well, actually, they should be used to not having fans, and then they finally actually win because they have no pressure and nobody's even watching. No one's watching. Except for Donnie. Donnie's the only one watching. I will admit, I love baseball, too, so I actually have been turning into the Rays because we do live in the greater Tampa Bay area. Mm-hmm. But no, Donnie, what Giants didn't do so hot. But, no. You know, the good news is that before the season started, they traded Madison Bumgarner within the division, which blew my mind. And I get it. Mad Bum was probably coming to the end, especially with his contract.
He was
his
gone.
His contract was the reason they needed to go. Thankfully, the Diamondbacks played like dog do. So
who'd have thought?
I'm actually okay with, and it ended up working out for us. We did bring back Hunter Pence and Pablo Sandoval for a cup of coffee.
Yeah,
and,
why'd you bring Pablo?
I don't know. For the three fans who were watching him on TV, who were like, "Yeah, Pablo."
My point is,
you had a point.
Yeah, the Giants crapped the bed.
There are worse teams.
Your three championships are done. Get it over with. Move on. Don't do the Yankee thing and hold on to those forever. All right?
Yeah, right.
Move on. The Rays and the Dodgers. That's it this year. Just throwing that out there.
I'll bring the trash cans.
Enjoy that. Got it. Okay. So that's what I get for running this end of the year. Usually it's better if he runs it.
That's all you had?
Yeah, that's okay. It.
Oh, all right.
We got more time to focus on the real stuff.
Let's go back. Why are you such a baseball fan? Is baseball your favorite sport?
Yes, baseball would be my favorite popular sport. It's
so, just for the record, did you say your favorite popular sport?
Yes, strongman's not popular.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, to be honest, baseball's not that popular either. I love baseball just as much as you do, you jack.
Ass.
But it's let's be honest, baseball is not popular anymore. You and I are like the only people in our 30s who watch baseball.
Well, everybody boycotts sports now. It's the cool thing to do, I guess.
Well,
no,
it has nothing to do with it. But even
watch
before
Netflix all day.
even before the situation we're in, baseball was going down.
So let me tell you why baseball is my favorite sport. Because I know you guys see like a big freaking lunk. I'm the guy that they made the lunk alarm for in Planet Fitness. I get it. But actually, I'm semi-intellectual, and I love the analytical side of baseball. I love following it. I love basing my guesses of what's going to happen based off of all kinds of measurable data. And baseball is the greatest at tracking measurable data throughout the years.
You can compare. I'm sorry, I keep cutting you off. I don't really care. You can compare like someone from 2020. Well, maybe not 2020. Someone in like the 21st century. And you can look at like their WAR, slugging percentage, all that stuff combined, and you can go back and compare it to someone in the 1920.
That's great.
And you have like the same data, and you can say objectively, you know, again, we already talked about the lack of black players and the dead ball era, but relatively objectively, you can compare someone and say, nope, this guy was better than that guy.
Absolutely.
You can't do that.
Without a lot of subjectivity like you talked about.
Because
you can do that right now. The basketball, who's the greatest ever, is so subjective.
Well, it is Michael Jordan. It's not really
subjective. I'm going to go with you on that one.
Yeah.
But it is very subjective because it all depends on your era. Like the guys that are older than us will say like the Celtics were the best team ever. You know, so it's all that. But you're right. With baseball, it's very measurable. And I like knowing, and you can ask Ashley, I like sitting there guessing, and I'm educated guessing of what's going to happen 2 to 3 moves ahead of time. Mm-hmm. And that's why the lack of action is okay with me, because I'm constantly thinking about this stuff. So that's why I enjoy baseball, as it keeps my brain moving outside of my normal work and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so. Well, I mean, it's really, I'm glad that you like the American League, because that's pretty much fast pitch softball compared to the National League, where the actual thinking takes place. My God.
We can't just get along, can we, Hayes?
When's the last time one of your pitchers hit a home run, huh?
It was probably like 10 years ago.
Yeah. Got it. I get it. Okay.
When they played in an NL game.
Did you grow up playing baseball?
I played a multitude of sports. I played baseball, golf. My dad was a golfer.
What?
Bowling.
Wait,
basketball.
Okay, hang on. I said sports.
Yeah, I know, right? No, I did a whole bunch of things. Baseball and basketball were my two big ones, and I actually played the majority of my younger youth in basketball. Surprisingly, that's all the doctors would let me play. I had a lot of hip injuries when I was younger, hip issues, so they wouldn't let me play a contact sport because apparently basketball is not contact. But anyway,
so. I'm trying to get a segue here.
Yeah, let's do it.
We today's episode is about youth sports injuries, particularly baseball injuries, but along those lines, also weight training, resistance strengthening for the youth athletes. I grew up before my rec specs couldn't fit into my helmet anymore. I actually played baseball as well. That's right. That's the reason I stopped playing. I couldn't see the ball. You know what happened my last season? I was 14. That was the last season of baseball that I played. And the reason I knew that I was done playing baseball and had to switch over to football and keep playing soccer was because I got hit by a pitch and I swung at the pitch before the pitcher even threw the ball, and then the pitch still hit me. And that's when I said
that takes talent.
And I think I'm done because I couldn't see a damn thing.
Yeah,
couldn't see a damn
thing.
Kind
of important in baseball.
I have contacts in. I could not see a damn thing. I blame that on my father. Forgive me. He used to have like Coke bottle thick glasses before he got his LASIK surgery.
Nice.
So I need the bigger ball.
And
I can see.
Thanks
I
to go, that hey. Football, you got a multitude of torn ACLs. Here we are.
Hey,
nice job.
You know, I wouldn't be here if it weren't for football.
That's true.
Right. Yeah. There you go. So where was I going with this? I don't know. I just want to humiliate myself about how bad I was at baseball.
I'm just
gonna
sit here and watch.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about sports. There has been an increase in the I'll go back. Technically, it's been an overall decrease in the injuries in youth baseball athletes, except for one body part, and that's the elbow. The elbow injury in youth baseball pitchers, players in general, that has skyrocketed over the last 10 to 15 years or so, and to the point where you have kids as young as 10, 11 years old having Tommy John surgery to repair what's called the ulnar collateral ligament right here in their elbow, which is very important to help stabilize the elbow when it comes to pitching. And that is a travesty. It's a travesty that we have come to this point in our society with everything else is going on, but youth sports have gotten to this point where we're treating youth sports, kids who are 7 and 8 years old, like
a farm system.
Like it's a farm system. Yep. Like your kid's going to play in the majors. Get out of here. He's not.
He's not.
All right. So, but there is a way, I believe it or not, there's a way to reduce injuries. You're not going to believe what the answer is to reducing injuries.
I thought it was just going to run a lot. Just going to go running a lot. Is that the way to do it?
That's it. That's it. Up your cardio.
Just up the cardio.
That's it. All right. Done. Next topic. No, there's a way to reduce injuries. It's been proven in the evidence to have injury reduction, reduced injury rates for youth baseball players, youth athletes in general, by strength training, some plyometrics as well, but strength training. So the question to start before we get to the baseball players is, Donnie, how young is too young to start strength training?
Wow.
Or what's, okay. You know, I'll rephrase. When do you think someone should start strength training?
Okay. So this is all coming based off of completely subjective information.
That's why
online.
You're here.
That's
you're here, here for anecdotes anecdotal and subjective reports.
And I throw in something funny every now and then. Yeah, no. I get it. That's how I make my money. All right, cool. So I'm going to sit here and say, let's talk about before strength training was an actual thing. Before Louis Cyr all of a sudden picked up a giant dumbbell and pressed it overhead, let's talk about what kids did, let's say in the Midwest, let's just go Midwest, when, as soon as they were able to, you know, function for the most part, they were helping out the farm, they were helping out move things around. Last I checked, and I have checked several times, hay bales are not light, all right? Hay bales are not light. You know, this type of stuff, bending them, picking up stuff off the ground, is a required movement for this kind of stuff. Now, where do they always say that the lineman that protects Tom Brady and the Patriots or where the Bucks or wherever he's at now, where are they always like the big ones from? Iowa, mm-hmm. Nebraska. Mm-hmm. All right, let's Idaho. Mm-hmm. The corn-fed big 350-pound 6 foot three. Yeah, Rhode Island. They all come from there. Actually, you're right. That's where majority come from. These kids have a lineage of strength training before it was strength training, and they didn't say, "Well, you got to wait till you're 15 to pick up this hay bale, son. We want to make sure your growth plates are fully developed." You know, no, they went out there. Now,
I'm sure it was all within the child labor laws.
Yeah, absolutely, completely compliant across the board, absolutely. So the point of that is now that we have some science behind it, some idea. Safely training is fine at a reasonable age. I'm not going to say an actual age because I don't really know
it's okay.
An age, and I'm sure you have something that'll show it there, but I don't believe that you have to be in puberty before you can start training. I do believe that you can start training at 9, 10 years old on a very safe and minimal level just to build up tendon strength, just to build the movement, muscle memory, that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. to get you into the point where when you come into your developmental years, you've already had the foundation ready to go. And I have a friend of mine who he started his son training in strongman at 9 years old. He literally picked up a medicine ball, had him put it on a keg, 15-pound medicine ball, put it on there, moved up to. This kid eventually became 2-time national champion for strongman for lightweight and heavyweight. Right, he went in there, and now he just finished up playing a linebacker for a college sport. And he's only 6 foot. And he was starting outside linebacker for a D2 program. Undersized, strong as hell.
There you go.
And it started from basic movement stuff before puberty.
Mm-hmm. Now it's the science part.
There we go.
Here you go. Now y'all can go to sleep. I'll wake you up in about 5 minutes. So to back up your anecdotes, yes. So as long as a child can adequately follow instructions and understand the risks, the kids probably as young as even 7 or 8 can engage in a strength training program. And the key at that point, in addition to the kid being able to follow instructions, so obviously there are individual, like let's take this on an individual basis, but the key is also the coaching at that point too. But let's talk about the benefits of strength training for youth and for adolescents. So, you know, several systematic reviews, meta-analyses show overwhelming support for strength training, resistance training in youth. So it improves muscular power, sport performance, long-term health, cardiovascular health, body composition, bone density, blood lipid profiles, self-esteem.
Ooh,
self-esteem,
that's a big one.
And it helps reduce injury.
So mental health is included in there as well.
Yeah. Weird, especially in you know, now we definitely sound like two old farts to talk about this day and age when I was a whippersnapper. But, you know, what we've seen, especially with everything that's going around right now, is that mental health is, it's always of importance, but I think it's of the utmost importance right now. And frankly speaking, over the last 6 months of everything that we've been going through, it's always been my safe place, but my training has helped me tremendously keep a level head during all of this, keep my family in as strong as we have ever been, and keep my business going during all this. And because I strength train, and because I've been strength training for the majority of my life.
Mm-hmm.
So
Yeah, we're getting to that point where, yeah, we've been doing this majority of our life.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely.
So, again, going back to, you know, strength training, whether it's safe for kids, again, coaching is of utmost importance when it comes to that. We need, with kids especially, we need continuous feedback. We probably need a little more visual cues, like using a mirror,
yep.
You know, to say, to have them look and to have them, give them the feedback that way. We also need to do some targeted neuromuscular coordination, coordination type of exercises too. Because just, you know, kids are, they're motor morons.
Very true.
Right?
They have all the ability.
Yeah.
just none of the knowledge.
They're like a baby deer.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you got to put it all together. Yep. And so that's where the coaching comes in, to really focus on that type of stuff. And then undervalued is using training logs. Writing stuff down. You can't just guess.
Track the results.
Track the results. Like, how is the kid responding to stuff? And kids get bored. We gotta switch it up. So, yeah. You know, you can't just walk into the gym and be like, all right, it's deadlift day for my first grader.
Yeah, hour and a half of deadlifts, congratulations. Yeah,
here we go.
Yeah.
You know, no, we
got 10 sets of eight.
Yeah, you know, so I see pediatric patrons occasionally in my clinic. And again, assuming they can understand what's going on and assuming they can communicate. But we gotta switch it up. Gotta make it fun. Yep. So we've shown that strength training can work for youth, as young as 7 or 8. We can safely start with that. So let's bring it back to the baseball. So, the Journal of Sports Health, 2012, so almost a decade ago, 5% of youth pitchers had an elbow injury serious enough to require surgery or retirement from baseball within 10 years. Retirement from baseball when you're 20.
Yeah.
Because you had an elbow injury that was that serious.
That's
insane.
That's damn near child neglect.
It is child neglect. So your daughter's been starting to play some baseball, right?
Yep, she's in her second year softball.
There you go. So what kinds of things have you been doing to help kind of monitor the situation?
So, first of all, we had her in gymnastics at 3 or 4 years old, like you said, learning how to move her body, understanding how to balance, understanding how to, you know, unilaterally support yourself, that kind of stuff. So that was a big beginning. And then when we talk about training a 6 or 7 year old in rotational sport exercises, what we're talking about here is just basic form. I would never, ever, ever try to have my daughter throw a curveball or a breaking ball or any kind of manipulation of the wrist and elbow through the ball. I'm trying to work on pure mechanics on that end. And then in the gym, we have some fun doing other stuff over there. But we're not bringing it to an adult level prematurely. And I'm actually an assistant coach on her team. And none of the kids that are on there will ever be on that as well under my tutelage. Simple as that. And even to the point where they get older, we're not going to do that. We're going to be mechanics, because at that point, like you said, at 10 years old, if you have damage to your UCL, outside of a freak of nature incident where your tendon strength is just not up to par, you need to look at whoever's coaching them and have a serious talk. As a parent, there would be a very serious talk about what was going on during that time.
Yeah. I've had this conversation one time. Fortunately, with a patient of mine, and because I had a kid who was a pitcher, he luckily didn't tear the UCL, but he had a stress fracture to his ulna to the point where the bone separated and it's insane, and I had to have a conversation and say, listen, like, we need to do something about this, like, this. Whatever's going on has been way too much. Like, this shouldn't happen. Otherwise, completely healthy. Doesn't have, like, osteoporosis or any of that type of stuff. Like, no freak systemic condition. It was just pure overuse. One of the reasons we wanted to have this episode was to talk about, when is it safe for kids to throw breaking balls? Is it safe for kids to throw breaking balls? And there's not there's not much out there in the evidence to say like this is the age to do it, right? So in addition to saying these injuries can be prevented, specifically medial elbow injury, inside elbow injuries, they can be prevented by doing proper strengthening programs, some stretching programs, some swings. The main thing that we found, because they did look at can kids throw breaking balls. But whether or not, here's a direct quote, whether or not youth athletes should throw breaking balls prior to skeletal maturity has been a controversial topic. The recent biomechanical study in youth athletes throwing various breaking and non-breaking pitches demonstrated no significant difference in arm slot position or muscle activation, the pelvis, torso, upper extremity. So this lends support to the argument that throwing a breaking ball is no more dangerous than throwing other pitches. So what that means is that it's not the act of throwing the breaking ball per se. The issue and what has led to all these injuries is the amount.
Yes.
The amount of pitches thrown is the issue. And there are a few suggestions out there, but essentially, you know, for people, kids that are like 9 or 10, it's like 50 pitches per game. And essentially goes up like 10 pitches for like every 2 year increment. It's like 10 pitches.
And then an extended break.
Extended break, you get like at least 72 hours for the 9 to 10 year olds, like 48 hours, you're a little older. Mm-hmm. So you're not throwing 100 pitches until maybe you're 17 or 18.
Yeah.
Right. So the main thing is that like these kids that are, they throw 50 pitches and then they go to practice and they throw another 50 pitches and then they have, you know, and then they warm up and then kids who also play catcher show an increase in injury
right,
as well
because they're
throwing it back to the pitcher or they're making the throw to second base. You have to monitor, and it goes back again to coaching and training logs, keeping track of this type of stuff. It's not hard to do. And kids should not be having these type of injuries.
And if you're going to take a responsibility on of coaching, whether it's paid or not, you really have to take that serious. Because you're talking about the development of children that can be damaged for good.
Yeah.
We're not talking about, it can be during that developmental stage of children. You're talking about either you're going to take somebody who can be healthy for a majority of life or is going to be dealing with injuries and having to come into Hayes' office systemically, coming in there constantly because of that. And that's as simple as that. And I'll say Little League Baseball has done a good job of making sure that the problem is they can't control what happens outside of the game. And that's where it comes down to coaching.
And that's what comes down to coaching and comes down to education of parents. So we just got deep, dog.
Yeah, we actually took that one pretty serious. And because we do take it serious because we both have children.
We do, yeah.
And this was something we would never want to see our kids go through, especially if it could be prevented. That's the biggest thing. And it can be prevented.
Yeah. Yeah.
I suppose that.
Yeah. This episode is brought to you by Balco.
UTD it. Yeah.
just give him an injection. Yeah. It'll be fine. Yeah. Bud Kilmer.
Back to Bud Kilmer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So with that said, Donnie, you know what time it
is. Oh, man. Let's see.
Time for everyone's favorite episode. Wait. Everyone's favorite part of
the episode.
Everyone's favorite segment of the episode.
Oh, Joe Biden over here.
Bro science myths.
Myths.
Or pet peeves.
Yeah.
Okay. Today we're going to take on a bro science myth. Yeah. We're going to talk about meal frequency. Donnie, I'm assuming that power line that you have right there, no big deal. Don't worry about that.
No big deal.
It's a ghost. It's a ghost.
It's a ghost. We're coming back for another episode. Oh, nice. Man. Here we go.
Oh, it's a ghost. I'm assuming that's like your 10th meal of the day.
Yeah.
Right?
10th meal. Actually, I don't actually eat any solid food anymore. It's pure power line.
Yeah.
Buy it at here.
We will accept your sponsorship.
Yes, absolutely.
Donnie, how many meals do you eat a day? As a 320-pound power lifter, how many meals do you eat a day?
Okay, so we're going to go back to it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I eat whenever and this is one thing. People say, before you're hungry. No, you don't. Your body has a great sense of telling you when you're hungry. Stan Efferding talks about this all the time. Like, if you're hungry, your body will let you know. It's not going to take 3 hours to go, oh, shit, we're hungry. We gotta get them food, and by then you're already catabolic. No, it's going to let you know. So I do plan on making sure that I get my meals so I don't start getting, my blood sugar down or whatever like that. But I don't know. Some days could be 4 meals. Some days it could be 3. Some days it could be 5. I will tell you that. I don't eat 8 meals a day. I don't have the time to do that. And most people don't, unless you're a professional athlete. I don't know anybody who can go, I got
Tommy.
I
mean, I don't think professional, unless you are a bodybuilder.
There you go.
And you are Jay Cutler. Like
waking up at 3 a.m. to scarf down some chicken
exactly.
rice. Yeah,
exactly. Got to eat like 12 cups of oatmeal and 24 egg whites. Like, no, you don't. You don't. You don't.
Nope.
You don't need to eat every 90 minutes. It's just not. It's not good for you. It's not. It's
How
not
about we start
benefit.
This? How about you start finding out what your basal metabolic rate is? Let's start there.
Yeah.
All right, and then divide it up based off of how many meals that you can reasonably eat. Some people, you know, if you're out in the field all day, you maybe can only eat three meals a day. That's okay.
Yeah.
Make sure you're getting in the proper nutrients. Make sure whatever your goal is, if you're trying to gain or lose, you're in that in that calorie range. Make sure that you're getting enough of the macronutrients to make sure that you're equalized out. But man, for crap, if it's 7 o'clock, you're like, oh, I gotta get three more meals in for the day. You're doing it all wrong.
When do you sleep?
Yeah.
Holy crap.
You're doing it wrong.
So, no, I mean, you know, you're going to be okay if you eat three squares. You're going to be okay. Maybe throw a snack in every once in a while. If you get hungry, if your body says, I'm hungry. Or if you feel like you're going to pass out, go get something to eat.
Yeah.
Right?
Focus on quality of food, not quantity.
Yeah, there you go. That's really the more important is the food's got to be good quality. So, I'm going to stop there. Ashley's telling us to stop.
Stop, yeah. Well, that's why she gets paid the big bucks. Yeah. We're just sitting here talking away.
Yeah, exactly. So, on that note, we're going to finish.
Yeah.
Guess what? This was episode 7.
Yes, for real this time.
For real this time.
Yeah.
Donnie, where can people find you on social media?
Facebook, Strength Performance Institute. Come like me. Maybe even star me. I don't know. And then Instagram, if you want to see the cool stuff, Instagram. / Donnie Kiernan. And that's DONNIE. KIERNAN.
Wait.
Maybe we can spell it out.
I feel like every episode you switch. You're a moron.
I gotta keep it interesting. You're the one that does the same thing over and over.
I don't. It's easy to find me. Yeah. It's easy. Okay. If you like us, well, if you like one of us, if you like a little bit, if you like Ashley, like the video. Subscribe to her channel. Share it to your friends, to your family members, to your grandma. Hey, grandma.
Yeah.
You can find me. I'm Dr. Hayes Estes, Premier Physical Therapy and Sports Performance in Clearwater, Florida. Type that in the Facebook. You'll find us. And we are on Instagram at Run. I'm doing slow mo this time.
Oh, man, that's going to be a new
Tampa Bay. Episode 7 out.
You done screwed it all up this time.
Mock.
Oh,
1-5.
Yeah. Hing. Yeah. Yeah.
Burr.
Yeah.
Pick him up. he was a catcher before he became a pitcher, so.
Wait, what? Sorry, my mind is my mind is in the corner.
Well, he had to break in somehow, you know.
We crush the ending every time.
Every time. Wait, come on, we gotta do it. Ready? Blow it up. That's super douchey.